Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents Icon by Frederick Forsyth. It was the summer when the price of a small loaf of bread topped 1,000,000 rubles. It was the summer of the third consecutive year of wheat crop failures and the second of hyperinflation. It was the summer when in the back alleys of the faraway provincial towns, the first Russians began dying of malnutrition. It was the summer when the president collapsed in his limousine too far from help to be saved, and an old office cleaner stole a document. After that, nothing would ever be the same. It was the summer of 1999. It was hot that afternoon, oppressively hot, and it took several blasts on the horn before the gatekeeper scurried from his hut to haul open the great timber doors of the cabinet building. The long black Mercedes 600 eased under the arch and out into Staria Ploshad. In the back of the Mercedes, President Cherkasov sat alone. In the front were his militia driver and the personal bodyguard assigned to him from the Alpha Group. As the last drab outskirts of Moscow gave way to the fields and trees of the open countryside, the mood of the President of Russia was one of profound gloom, as well it might be. He had been 3 years in the office he had won after stepping in to replace the ailing Boris Yeltsin, and as he watched his country crashing into destitution, they had been the 3 most miserable years of his life. Back in the winter of 1995, when he had been the prime minister, appointed by Yeltsin to lick the economy into shape, the Russian people had gone to the polls to elect a new parliament, or Duma. Boris Yeltsin, recovering from a second heart attack in 3 months, watched the parliamentary elections from a clinic and saw his own political protégés hammered into third place among the delegates. The new force on the political horizon in the winter of 1995 was, ironically enough, the communists. After 70 years of communist tyranny, 5 years of Gorbachev reforms, and 5 years of Yeltsin, the Russian people began to look back with nostalgia to the old days. The communists, under their leader, Gennady Zhuganov, painted a rosy picture of the way things used to be. The Russian voters were in a state of disillusion with the two once heralded saviors, capitalism and democracy. For many Russians, looking around at the all-embracing corruption and pandemic crime, it had all been a big lie. When the parliamentary votes were counted, the crypto-communists had the biggest single block of deputies in the Duma. At the other extreme were their apparent opposites, the neo-fascists of Vladimir Zhirinovsky, leading the ironically named Liberal Democratic Party. In the 1991 elections, this crude demagogue had done amazingly well, but his star was falling. Nevertheless, it had not fallen enough to rob him of the second largest block of deputies. In the middle were the political center parties, clinging to the economic and social reforms they had introduced. They came in third. The real effect of those elections was to prepare the ground for the presidential race of 1996. The dozen parties of the center united into the Democratic Alliance with the key question whether Boris Yeltsin would be fit enough to stand for and win the presidency. His downfall would later be ascribed by historians to a single word, Chechnya. Exasperated to the breaking point 12 months earlier, Yeltsin had launched the full might of the Russian army and air force against a small, warlike mountain tribe whose leader was insisting on complete independence from Moscow. Yeltsin's impetuous decision led not to a quick and glorious victory, but to the utter destruction of the Chechen capital of Grozny and to the endless train of Russian soldiers and body bags. With their capital reduced to rubble, the Chechens took to the hills and refused to be flushed out. As they saw their sons coming back from the Caucasus in sacks, the mood of the Russian people turned viciously anti-Chechen. It also turned against the man who could not deliver them a victory. By the early summer, after grueling personal effort, Yeltsin re-won his presidency after a runoff. But a year later, he was gone. The mantle passed to the technocrat Yosef Cherkasov, leader of the Russian Homeland Party, by then part of the broad Democratic Alliance. Cherkasov seemed to have started well. Heeding Western advice, he negotiated at last a peace deal with Chechnya. But things began to go wrong within 18 months. The causes for this were twofold. First, that the depredations of the Russian mafia simply became too burdensome for the Russian economy to bear. And second, yet another foolish military adventure. In late 1997, Siberia threatened to secede. President Cherkasov, seemingly oblivious of his predecessor's mistakes in Chechnya, sent the army east. After 12 months without a military solution, he had to negotiate a deal, granting the Siberians far more autonomy than they ever had had. Secondly, the adventure triggered hyperinflation. In addition, the wheat crop had failed twice, in 97 and 98. In the cities, bread prices spiraled. President Cherkasov clung to office, but was clearly no longer in power. In Moscow, the capital and showcase of the nation, the destitute slept out on the quays along the Moskva and in the back alleys. The police, called the militia in Russia, tried to pick them up and hustle them onto trains heading back where they came from, but more kept arriving. In the early spring of 1999, the West gave up pouring subsidies into the bottomless pit and pulled out. The Russian economy lay down by the side of the road and died of despair. This was the gloomy prospect that President Cherkasov contemplated as he drove that hot summer's day out to his weekend retreat. President Cherkasov felt himself to be short of breath. He pushed the button to open the rear window and let air blow over him. It was hot and made his breathing little better. Behind the partition screen, neither driver nor bodyguard had noticed. The turnoff came up on the right. As they passed it, the president of Russia fell sideways across his seat. The first thing the driver noticed was that the president's head had disappeared from his rearview mirror. The bodyguard turned round to look. The president was half on his back, half on his side, both hands clutching at his chest, eyes closed, breathing in short grunts. The nearest hospital was miles away in the Sparrow Hills. Once there, the president was rushed to the ICU. They used what they had, the latest and the best, but they were still too late. At 4:10, the senior physician shook his head. Six hours later, far out on the rolling surface of the Caribbean, the foxy lady turned for home. Julius the boatman hauled in the lines. It had been a full-day charter, and a good one. The skipper on the upper bridge eased the throttles forward. He reckoned he would be sliding into Turtle Cove in less than an hour. The foxy lady seemed to know her work was over, and her berth in the sheltered harbor up the quay from the tiki hut was waiting for her. When Zhirinovsky had been leader of the Liberal Democrats, the party headquarters were in a shabby slum of a building in Fish Alley, just off Sretenka Street. Visitors, not aware of the strange ways of Vlad the Mad, had been amazed to discover how tawdry it was. This was the way the eccentric fascist had preferred to keep the headquarters, on the grounds that the image spoke of a man of the people, rather than one of the fat cats. But Zhirinovsky was long gone now, and the Liberal Democratic Party had been amalgamated with the other ultra-right and neo-fascist parties into the Union of Patriotic Forces. Its undisputed leader was Igor Komarov, and he was a completely different kind of man. Nevertheless, seeing the logic of showing that the Union of Patriotic Forces permitted itself no expensive indulgences, he kept the Fish Alley building, but maintained his own private offices elsewhere. Trained as an engineer, Komarov had worked under communism, but not for it, until halfway through the Yeltsin period he had decided to enter politics. He had chosen the Liberal Democratic Party, and in a series of covert meetings had stitched together the alliance of all the right-wing elements in Russia into the UPF. By 1998, Komarov was undisputed leader of the ultra-right and in prime position to play upon the growing despair of the Russian people. Yet among all this poverty and destitution, there was also ostentatious wealth to make the eyes blink. Those who had money had mountains of it, much of it in foreign currency. In the Duma, the delegates shouted and passed resolutions. "It reminds me," said an English foreign correspondent, "of all I ever heard of the last days of the Weimar Republic." The one man who seemed to offer a possible ray of hope was Igor Komarov. Komarov made his mark as a passionate and charismatic popular orator. When he was on the podium, those who recalled the quiet, soft-spoken, fastidious private man were amazed. He quickly mastered the area of his own specialty, the living crowd. He avoided the television interview, aware that though these might work in the West, they were not for Russia. Russians rarely invited people into their home.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.